राष्ट्रपति प्रणब मुखर्जी की वीडोल पल पार्लमेंट सेंट्रल हॉल कार्यक्रम की एमपील हाजर लोकसभा स्पीकर सुमित्रा महाजन उपराष्ट्रपति हमीद अंसारी प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी कार्यक्रम कार्यक्रम चूद्दाम
for organizing this warm farewell to me. Thank you, Honorable Speaker. Thank you, Honorable Chairman. Thank you, Honorable Members of both the Houses. Honorable Members, if I claim I am the creation of this parliament, perhaps it will not be treated as immodesty. This parliament created as an individual my political outlook and persona which has been shaped by this temple of democracy. Bear with me if I feel nostalgic and indulge myself by going back to the past. On 26 January 1950, the Constitution of India came into effect. In a remarkable display of idealism and courage, we, the people of India, gave to ourselves a sovereign democratic republic to secure to all its citizens justice, liberty, and equality. We undertook to promote amongst all citizens fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and ensuring the unity of the nation. These ideals became the lodestar of modern Indian state. The Indian Constitution, consisting of 395 articles and 12 schedules, is not merely a legal document for the administration, but the Magna Carta of a socio-economic transformation of a vast multitude of people living in India. It represents the hopes and aspirations of a billion plus people. 68 years ago, after the first general election, the Indian Parliament began its journey representing the sovereign will of its people. Both the houses were constituted. The first President of the Republic was elected, who addressed the first joint session of the Parliament, and the Indian parliamentary system rolled out. Honorable Members, when I first entered the portals of this hallowed institution 48 years ago, I was 34 years old. In July 1969, I came to the Parliament as a member of Raj Sabha, representing one of the six seats from the state of West Bengal. My election to Raj Sabha took place on 4th July, and the first session I attended was 22nd July 1969. Honorable Members, since then, for the last 37 years, I served as a member of Loksabha and Raj Sabha. Of these, I served 5 terms as member of the Raj Sabha, 4 times being elected from West Bengal and 1 time from Gujarat. And 2 terms in Lok Sabha. My long career has been instructive and educative. I entered Parliament at a time when the Rajya Sabha was full of experienced parliamentarians, leaders of the freedom movement, many of whom were brilliant speakers. M.C. Chagla, Ajit Prasad Jain, Jairam Das Daulatram, Bhupesh Gupta, Joachim Alva, Mahavir Tyagi, Raj Narayan, Dr. Bhai Mahavir, Loknath Mishra, Chitto Basu, and many others. In fact, Bhupesh Gupta was truly a legend in the Rajya Sabha. From 1952, till his death, 1981, he was the member of Raj Sabha. Dayabhai Patel and Monibel Patel, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel's son and daughter, represented Swatantra Party in the Parliament. My years in Parliament were further enriched by the wisdom of P.V. Narasimha Rao, oration of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, cryptic one-liners of Muthulimai and Dr. Nathpai, wit and humor of Piru Modi, poetic discourses of Professor Hiren Mukherjee, a reserve repartee of Indrajit Gupta, coming presence of Dr. Manmohan Singh, mature advice of L.K. Advani, and passionate support of Sonia Gandhi for social legislations. Fellow members, my career as a parliamentarian was no doubt mentored by Srimati Indira Gandhi. Her steely determination, clarity of thought, and decisive actions made her a towering personality. She never hesitated to call a spade a spade. I remember after the defeat of Congress and herself in the post-emergency election, we had gone to London in November 1978. A large number of media persons in a fairly aggressive mood were waiting to ask Srimati Gandhi questions. The first question that was flung at her was, I quote, "What have been your gains from the emergency?" Unquote. Looking at the journalist squarely in the eye, in a level voice, Indira Gandhi replied, "In those 21 months, we comprehensively managed to alienate all sections of Indian people." There was a broad silence for a moment, followed by huge laughter, and thereafter there was no question in the waiting room of Heathrow Airport, and the media persons just melted away. And I also learned an early lesson of acknowledging my mistakes and rectifying them. Self-correction in such situation is always a better option than self-justification. Honorable members, in those days, both houses of the Parliament used to reverberate with animated discussions and illuminative and exhaustive debates on social and financial legislations. Listening to the stalwarts for hours and days in Parliament, sitting in the Treasury or opposition benches, I felt one with the soul of this living institution, understood the real value of debate, discussion, and dissent. I realized how disruption hurts the opposition more than the government, as it denies them the opportunity to raise the concerns of the people. I internalized the sense of what Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had said, and I quote, "There has always to be a balance of change, balancing of change and continuity. The system of parliamentary democracy embodies these principles of change and continuity, and it is up to those who function in this system, members of the House and the numerous others who are part of this system, to increase the pace of change, to make it as fast as they like, subject to the principle of continuity. If continuity is broken, we become rootless and the system of parliamentary democracy breaks down." Unquote. Honourable members, I experienced the joy of the enactment of pro-poor and pro-farmer legislations, the recent passage of goods and service tax, and its launch on 1st July is a shining example of cooperative federalism and speaks volumes for the maturity of Indian Parliament. To be a part of this system is a unique experience, and I am grateful to the people of this great country for giving me this opportunity. I had the privilege of being a witness and a participant in the unfolding scenario of emergence of a great India, an India where 130 crore people belonging to three major ethnic groups, Aryans, Dravidians, Mongoloids, practicing seven major religions and 122 languages in the daily lives, live yet under one constitution, one flag, and one administrative system. Honourable members, not a single part of this vast territory of 3.3 million square kilometers of landmass and islands is underrepresented in the parliament. 543 persons from 543 territorial constituencies of this country, representing the people in Lok Sabha, and 245 persons elected by 29 states and union territories, including 12 nominated members by president, make laws, scrutinize orders of the executive, and enforce accountability to protect the interests of the people. Each of these 790 voices is important. It is unfortunate that parliamentary time devoted to legislations has been declining. With the heightened complexity of administration, legislation must be preceded by scrutiny and adequate discussion. Scrutiny in committee is no substitute to open discussion on the floor of the House. When the parliament fails to discharge its lawmaking role or enacts laws without a discussion, I feel it breaches the trust reposed in it by the people of this great country. Through the instrument of ordinance, the executive has been vested with extraordinary powers to make laws to meet exigencies during a time when parliament is not in session. However, Such ordinances have to be approved by Parliament within 6 weeks from the next session of the Parliament. I am firm in the opinion that the ordinance route should be used only in compelling circumstances, and there should be no recourse to ordinance on monetary matters. Ordinance routes should not be taken on matters which are being considered or have been introduced in the House or a committee of the House. If a matter is deemed urgent, the concerned committee should be made aware of the situation and should be mandated to present its report within the stipulated time. Honourable members, it was in July 2012 again. My membership in Lok Sabha came to an end when I was declared elected as the 13th President of the Republic on 22nd of that month. Even though 37 years of my life in Parliament came to an end on that day, but still I continued to have a tenacious link with the institution. In fact, I became an integral part of it as President of the Republic as per Constitution. Article 79 of the Constitution says, there shall be a President for the Union which shall consist of the President and the two Houses, to be known respectively as the Council of States and the House of People. In these 5 years, my principal responsibility was to function as the guardian of the Constitution. As I had said on oath, I strived to preserve, protect and defend our Constitution, not just in word but also in spirit. In this task, I greatly benefited from the advice and cooperation extended by Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi at every step. With passion and energy, he is driving transformational changes in the country. I will carry with me fond memories of our association and his warm and courteous behavior to me. As I retire from the office of the President of the Republic, my association with the Parliament also comes to an end. I will no longer be a part of the Parliament of India. It will be with a tinge of sadness and a rainbow of memories that I will be leaving this magnificent building today. Honourable members, with a sense of gratitude and a prayer in my heart, I take leave of you. I leave with a sense of fulfilment and happiness of having served the people of this great country through this institution as their humble servant. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Jai Hind.